Good morning and welcome to everyone. We're glad you're here, whether you're here in person or whether you're listening on the radio or watching on YouTube or Facebook, welcome. I'm glad you could worship with us. We're going to start this morning with a call to worship. It's in number 523 in your hymnals. So if you could stand together. Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. If I walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let's sing the doxology together. Standing as we sing hymn number 503, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart, 503. One more time and think about floods of joy over our souls. Maybe we see it on your faces there.
Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy on my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Now let's do the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may be seated.
I do. Good morning. It is good to be with you this morning in worship. Let's pray. Since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy, like sea billows roll. You have come to give us life. You have come to give us life abundantly and free. Oh, Father, God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, we come this morning in worship to praise you. We come to hear your words. We come to experience life together with one another. We thank you for your presence with us in this room. We thank you for your presence with those who are watching. Because, God, we know that you are here. You are very near to each one of us. You have called us by name. You know us. You know where we've been. You know where you want us to go. And so as we journey together today, as we journey together throughout the days and weeks ahead, would you guide us? Would you help us to know the direction that we are to go? There are so many things that are confusing and difficult right now, things that we struggle with. Father, would you help us to navigate your world at this time? There's friends and family who are sick, who need your touch of healing. I pray, God, that you would be with them now, that your arms of love and care, the power to heal from your Holy Spirit, would embrace each one of those people in need. We pray that those around them who are loving them, God, that you would give them the strength and the ability to support them, that your peace would be with them. Father, we pray for family and friends that are all around the world. We pray, God, as we are distant from them, that you would be with them. Help us to remember to reach out to them. I thank you for technology. I thank you that we can be on the air and that those people who aren't with us here are still with us. I thank you for phone calls and even letters. God, the written word is so important. Help us to reach out to one another. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your life through Jesus. We thank you for his example. Father, give us the grace and the courage to follow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together again as we prepare to hear God's word. We will worship together.
Thank you.
praise you this morning. We thank you for who you are. Thank you, Lord, that you are here. We lift up our praise to you. Formed us, and brought us into your family. Lord, we thank you for your love for us. And as we celebrate today, as we worship you, we just pray that you'll be glorified. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Our focus this summer is on stories and the stories that we tell. We tell stories of all kinds, in all different ways. There's legends, there's fables, there's novels, there's poetry. We have our own family stories, right? They often get told whether we like it or not. I know that there are some family stories I would rather my brother not tell to his congregation in Delaware about me. But he does. I'm glad I'm not in Delaware. Often those stories get shared orally with family and friends, and they stay pretty close to home. Sometimes we write them down. Sometimes one of the things that I had asked my grandmother to do long ago was to write down some of the poems that she had recited to me and to my father so that I could remember them. So sometimes we ask others to write their stories. And sometimes they make it into print. Aretha Beardsley passed away this last week. The flowers here are from her funeral that was held on Friday. During, as they were preparing for the funeral, they had come across a recent printing of some of the stories and poems that Aretha had written. Who knew she was a poetress, a poet? There you go. Who knew she was a poet? I didn't. And they had these printed up. So there's this pamphlet out on the table in the back, if you'd like to take one. It's got a couple of stories. I'm going to read one for us. And a couple of poems. Her poems are absolutely beautiful. Her word, her work, her writing made it to print. I'm going to share one of her stories with us this morning. It's called A Pig Feed Found by Aretha Beardsley. Shortly after my husband and I were married, we decided to raise a couple of pigs. We already had a barn full of cows to milk, but since we were both born and raised on farms, this was no problem. But the pigs were another story. One day, my husband came running to the house yelling, "The pigs are out!" It's about impossible to catch a pig or to drive a pig, so I dashed to the barn to get a bucket of pig feed, and I mixed it with some water to coax them back to the pen. As I was hurrying toward the pig pen with the feed and the pigs in hot pursuit, I stubbed my toe, and not wanting to spill my bucket of food, I set the bucket down with a jolt, my hands going each side of it and my face right down over it. The stuff in the bucket flew up out of the bucket all over my face and hair and immediately started to dry on me. I looked up, and my husband was laughing his head off. At first, I found myself getting mad, but then thought how funny I must look with pig slop all over my face and two little pigs running all around me. I had to laugh at myself. We finally got the little fellas back in the pen. After that experience, we decided to raise chickens instead. When I read that story, I laughed. I have had a similar experience, but with cows in a barn before the manure had been taken out. It's not a pretty sight, and my father was laughing, and I was not. When I read that story, I could just imagine Aretha. And if you knew her at all, you knew her smile. And I can just imagine her picking her head up out of that bucket and thinking what she must look like, and looking at her husband, and then grinning from ear to ear at how silly this experience was. That was an animated story in my mind. Animation is a great way to tell a story. We see the action, we see facial expressions, the scenery, the surrounding scenery is beautiful in animation. We hear the words, we feel what's going on. One of my favorite animated movies, obviously, is Up. The animation is beautiful. It's fun. It's so full of color. The characters are interesting. I find I can relate to each one of them and their experiences and their emotions. The story itself is fun and engaging and very thought-provoking. In this movie, lives are changed as each one interacts with the other. So I want us to look first at two of the main characters. We'll begin with Mr. Fredrickson. Now, I like Mr. Fredrickson. He's cool. He reminds me of my dad, Mr. Frederick. We meet him first as an elderly gentleman who lives alone and is a little bit crotchety at this time. Events from his past haunt him. He changes around him at the moment right now when we meet him, make him tense and angry and afraid. He lives in the house he and his wife Ellie lived in for many, many years, and she has passed away. Next, we meet Russell. The best way to introduce Russell is to watch this clip.
Good afternoon. My name is Russell, and I am a wilderness explorer in Tribe 54, Sweat Lodge 12. Are you in need of any assistance today, sir?
No.
I could help you cross the street.
No.
I could help you cross your yard.
No.
I could help you cross your porch.
No.
Well, I gotta help you cross something.
No, I'm doing fine.
Good afternoon. My name is Russell, and I am a wilderness explorer in Tribe 54.
Slow down.
Sweat Lodge 12.
Kid!
Are you in need of
any
assistance?
Thank you, but I don't need
today?
Any help.
Ow.
Proceed.
Good afternoon.
Let's skip to the end.
See these? These are my wilderness explorer badges. You may notice one is missing. It's my assisting the elderly badge. If I get it, I will become a senior wilderness explorer. The wilderness must be explored! Gah, gah! Rah! It's gonna be great. There's a big ceremony, and all the dads come, and they pin on our badges.
So, you want to assist an old person?
Yep. Then I will be a senior wilderness explorer.
You ever heard of a snipe?
Snipe?
Bird. Beady eyes. Every night it sneaks in my yard and gobbles my poor azaleas. I'm elderly and infirm. I can't catch it. If only someone could help me.
Me! I'll do it!
Oh, I don't know. It's awfully crafty. You'd have to clap your hands 3 times to lure it in.
I'll find them, Mr. Fredrickson!
I think its burrow's 2 blocks down.
If you 2 blocks past... down, got it! Snipey.
That's Russell. He's fun-loving, he's outgoing, he's after his goal. He's got something to do. He just needs to help an elderly person get across something to get his final badge, to become that, I don't know, master scout, whatever he said. The relationship between he and Mr. Fredrickson grow as the movie progresses, and Mr. Fredrickson ends up learning an awful lot from Russell and their experiences together. You need to watch the movie if you've never watched the movie. It's great. So, Mr. Fredrickson gets fed up with his circumstances. He remembers a promise that he made to his wife, and with the goal of keeping that promise, he devises a way to escape his current miserable existence. After tying thousands of balloons to the roof of his house, we have just about 30 here, he lands within sight of his destination, a part of South Africa near a place called Paradise Falls. This is where he had promised Ellie, his wife, years earlier to visit. It should have been wonderful, but he just didn't feel it. From then on, nothing seemed to go right. Russell ends up with him in South America. A strange talking dog seems to have adopted him, and a big bird needs his help. A snipe? All these distractions keep him from the goal of getting his house to the edge of the falls where he promised Ellie they would live. And he becomes more angry and frustrated. Just as he's about to give up on his promise to Ellie and let the dream go, he finds strength again. He's renewed and is ready for another adventure. Let's watch this clip.
I don't want this anymore.
Thank you.
He crosses his heart at the end. The very beginning of the movie, he and Ellie are children, and he crosses his heart to her at one moment. And throughout the movie, as you watch it, you'll notice several times that he crosses his heart. He crosses his heart again. Why? Because she said, "We've had a great life. Go have more." In my adventure book, there were pages that he had never seen before. He thought the stuff I'm going to do was blank, that he had let a dream die. But when he turned those pages and saw their life together through Ellie's eyes, rather than his eyes of failure and a lost dream, he was changed. He had hope, he had a new adventure, and he picked up the badges and knew he had something more to do. Let's watch what he did.
I'm gonna help Kevin, even if you won't!
No, Russell, no!
I love you. Can I stay?
Can you stay? Well, you're my dog, aren't you? And I'm your master.
You are my master? Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Good boy, Doug. Yeah, good boy.
Now, you're going to have to watch all of the movie to figure out what happened next. That's only about half. And that's where we stop today. He had a new vision of what his life could be. He was able to let go of the things that were holding him down, literally. Right? He had new purpose, he had a new goal, and he went to find Russell and the next part of the adventure. You know, Simon Peter had a similar experience in the book of Acts. He had a life-changing event as well. And I'd like you to turn with me, if you would, on page 1091. We're going to start at chapter 10, and I'm going to read some of this. Page 1091. But the book of Acts, yeah. Chapter 10. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of what was known as the Italian cohort, a devout man who feared God with all his household, gave alms generously to the people, and prayed continually to God. About the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God come in and say to him, "Cornelius." And he stared at him in terror and said, "What is it, Lord?" He said to him, "Your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa and bring one Simon, who is called Peter. He's lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea." When the angel who spoke to him had departed, he called two of his servants and a devout soldier from among those who attended him. And having related everything to them, he sent them to Joppa. The next day, As they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the housetop about the sixth hour to pray. And he became hungry and wanted something to eat. But while they were preparing it, he fell into a trance and saw the heavens opened and something like a great sheet descending, being let down by its four corners upon the earth. In it were all kinds of animals and reptiles and birds of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice came to him again a second time, "What God has made clean, do not call common." This happened three times, and the thing was taken up at once to heaven. Now while Peter was inwardly perplexed as to what the vision that he had seen might mean, behold, the men who were sent by Cornelius, having made inquiry for Simon's house, stood at the gate and called out to ask whether Simon, who was called Peter, was lodging there. And while Peter was pondering the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Behold, three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them." And Peter went down to the men and said, "I am the one you're looking for. What is the reason you're coming?" And they said, "Cornelius, a centurion, an upright and God-fearing man who was well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation, was directed by a holy angel to send for you to come to his house and to hear what you have to say." So he invited them in to be his guests. The next day he rose and went away with them, and some of the brothers from Joppa accompanied him. And on the following day they entered Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter lifted him up and saying, "I'm just a man too." And as he talked with him, he went in and found many persons gathered. And he said to them, "You yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. I ask then why you sent for me." So then Cornelius begins to tell him the story of the angel visiting him. In verse 34, Peter says, "So Peter opened his mouth and said, 'Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed." And then Peter goes on to tell what they knew as believers. In verse 44, we catch up again. While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word, and the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. Now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, "You went to circumcised men and ate with them." And then skipping back to 17, because Peter then reiterates all that had transpired. Verse 17, he says, "If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way?" When they heard these things, they fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, "Then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life." Because Cornelius listened to the voice of God and sought out Peter, because Peter listened to the voice of God and obeyed, because they were willing to talk to one another, listen to one another, and to God, Peter's mind was changed, and he and the circumcision party realized God's bigger picture for his chosen people, every single one of us. God's message of love, grace, and forgiveness through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus and the gift of the Holy Spirit had been given to everyone who believes. Peter and the Jewish believers had their minds changed. God opened their eyes to bigger truth. Now, what about all of that? We can be a lot like Rita, getting angry at how messy we are. Or we can choose to laugh, to clean up, and go on. We can be a lot like Mr. Fredrickson. We get focused on what isn't or what wasn't, rather on what is and what could be. We get stuck. We miss the adventure along the way. We miss the adventure of this day. We're not free to move on to bigger possibilities. We hold on to the things of the past, hoping that they will give us life. Now, we don't have to lose the memories. Mr. Fredrickson kept the book, but he let go of the things that were holding him down. When we let go of the fears and the regrets that hold us down, we're free to move on to our next adventure as well. We can be a lot like Peter, who held on to what he thought was right until God spoke directly to him and asked him to change. He'd learned what he believed. He had learned that, but God had something more, something different. He was faced with a dilemma, but that's not how I understood it before. He listened, he believed, and he changed his way of thinking. God uses people, all kinds of people, annoying little kids, cranky, crotchety old folks, pigs in slop buckets. His scripture, the Holy Spirit, God uses all of these to open our eyes also. We need to be willing to hear, to listen, to allow God and others to challenge, to encourage, and to change us. Jesus said, "I have come that they, his sheep who hear his voice, may have life and have it to the fullest." Are you, am I, ready and willing to listen, to act, and to be changed, to adventure with God in a new way? Let's start by letting him know, "Yeah, I'm willing," or, "I'm not quite ready, God. I'm not quite ready, but I'll hang in there." Then we spend time with him. We read his word. We open ourselves up to a new voice, to a voice anew from him. We question, we trust, we respond to what we hear. We listen to others as they share their experience of God. We prepare and, I think, expect to be challenged and renewed and encouraged and made alive with God for a greater purpose, to live life to its fullest. That's what God asks of each one of us, like he asked of Peter when he changed his mind. Are you willing, am I willing, to respond to the next call that God has on each of our lives? Let's pray. Father God, you speak to us. You work in our lives. You bring people into our lives and circumstances, and all of those can point to you if we choose to listen and see through your eyes. Would you help us to do that? Would you give us the courage? Would you give us the strength? Would you make us willing? You are God, and there is no other. You love us. You are gracious. You accept us where we are. Teach us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. So now go and watch the movie.
Let's stand together as we respond, singing, "Your grace still amazes me." Thank you that you have a plan for our lives, no matter what stage we are in our lives, that you have a plan. Help us to follow you, Lord. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we announce, you may be seated.
All right, we have some announcements, just looking forward to the week. So tonight at the Joneses compound, we'll say, on Garden Street. There's campfire at 7 o'clock, so everyone's welcome. Bring chairs and a singing voice. Oh, and bring your favorite quote. When you come to a fork in the road, take it. Oh boy, sounds so good. Also for announcements, we need people still to sign up for the sanctuary cleaning and bathroom cleaning. So if you feel like that is a way that you can serve our family, that would be wonderful. Also VBS coming up in August, the end of the month of August. I forget the dates, 25th, 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th. Anyway. Sign up for your kids for that. Community members, tell them about that to sign up. And if you want to be a crew leader or a helper, please see Kylie to sign up. I think there's clipboards in the atrium to sign up for both of those, cleaning and VBS. And then again, the offering boxes at the back of the sanctuary, the three boxes, if you want to drop your offering there too. And what's that? Oh, and if you want to give to the Fellowship Fund, there's offering envelopes in the pews in front of you. Just designate Fellowship Fund on that, and you can drop those in there, too. And that's a great way that we can serve people in our community beyond what we already are doing. So, anything else? Okay, that's it.
All right, so let's close with Gloria Patri. I want to stay.